Hello, everybody, and welcome to Park Central Church today. I'm David, and I'm the pastor here. And I always say this every week, but I'm really thrilled that you've clicked on this link, or you found this video, or you found our Facebook page, or YouTube page, or however you got here. I'm just really glad that you're able to join with us for church this morning. Now, just because we're meeting in a building, or just because we're maybe sat in our living room or sat in our bed or out for a walk, however you're watching this, you know, we're still one, we're still united together. This is still church, it's still the same. You know, it's still us hearing from what God has to say to us where we are. And I love being in a building together. I love being with other Christians. I love worshiping together. I love being physically present with people. But, you know, we also get that that's not always possible, that people aren't always able to do it for a number of different reasons. You know, for sickness or for, you know, busy diaries or summer holidays, whatever. So, you know, wherever you're watching this, you know, and wherever you're watching this online and unable to be with us in the building, I really hope that you are blessed. I really hope that God speaks to you where you're at today, that you get a glimpse of who he is, a new revelation of who God is and who Jesus is and what his word is saying to us today. It's been a great week weather-wise, and you know, we've had a bit of a change from last week where it was glorious sunshine and we were all you know, trying to find shelter and refuge from the heat, to now just rushing in from our cars to try and find a little bit of refuge from the rain. Typical British weather, I guess. But whatever you've done this week, well, I guess, yes, yeah, it's school holidays now, isn't it? So we should expect the rain. But whatever you've been up to this week, I really hope that you've had a good time. I hope, like I said last week, that you managed to get some rest, you know, during this traditional summer holiday period. And that we're able to recoup and rest our souls and rest our bodies to get ready for the upcoming season. I was going to say, I hope you're all enjoying a bit of a break from me, but you're obviously listening to me right now. But from the messages last week, you know, we heard from Al, and it was just a great message, just again, a really encouraging message of a psalm that points us to Jesus, a psalm that is written in the Old Testament that looks forward to the future coming of the King of Kings, where he says, "Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord? Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory." And today, you know, I'm not going to be bringing the talk again. We've got another guest speaker, and this week's talk is from my lovely wife, Esther. And she's just going to be sharing some thoughts on Psalm 27 today. And I love the last verse in this psalm. I think it says, "Wait for the Lord, be strong, and let your heart take courage." But before we get there, and before we hear what Esther has to say, I just wanted to share this passage, just a short passage from Titus this morning in the New Testament. I shared it on our church WhatsApp group the other day, and to be honest, it's still encouraging me now. So hopefully it will encourage you too. So it's Titus chapter 3, just verses 3 to 8, I think it says, "For we ourselves were once foolish, disobedient, led astray, slaves to various passions and pleasures, passing our days in malice and envy, hated by others and hating one another. But when the goodness and loving kindness of God our Saviour appeared, he saved us, not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy, by the washing of regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us richly through Jesus Christ our Saviour, so that being justified by his grace, we might become heirs according to the hope of eternal life." And it's just a brilliant promise that we can hold on to. It's a wonderful future that we have and that we can hope in. And those who are true Christians can really hold fast to that promise. And if you're not a Christian today, or if you aren't sure whether you're a Christian or not, then you too can also be certain of that hope, that inheritance, that promise of eternal life in heaven by simply just acknowledging your sin, you know, that you are broken. You're unworthy in the sight of God due to the nature that we have been born into, all of us. But I also believe that we are created to be image bearers of God, and that he has made a way for us to be reconciled back to him, you know, and that way was made when Jesus died on the cross, that he willingly obeyed his Father onto the cross, and the blood that he shed was the price paid for our sin, for your sin and for my sin. And because he paid the price, it means that we don't have to. That the wrath of God is no longer on those who believe in him, because Jesus took it all on his shoulders. And because of what Jesus did, you can be free. You can be forgiven. You can be made new and have a new life in Jesus Christ because of the finished work of the cross. You know, Christianity is not an exclusive club in one sense. You know, the message of the gospel is available to all and everyone who hears it. But when we hear it, we have a choice to make, whether to believe it or not. And today, I just want to encourage you, you know, through this service, you know, through the songs and especially through the word that Esther's going to bring, to really question whether you believe this Jesus, that he died for you, that he is real today, that he's working today. Why, you know, why would I be here otherwise? Why would Esther be bringing this message? Because we believe that he is real. Because we believe that he changes lives. I know that he changed my life, and I believe that he can change yours too. So let's pray. Lord, thank you. Just today, we thank you for this opportunity to come and worship and serve and pray and hear from your word today. And Lord, I pray that the reading of your word and the teaching of your word will just be blessed today, that we will be encouraged, but we will be challenged as well, Lord, that your word will become alive to everyone who listens. Lord, I thank you that you died on a cross for me, Lord. I thank you died on a cross for the sake of the world, you say, Lord, and that you took the punishment that I deserve. You paid the price that should have been mine. You took on the punishment for all the sins that I've ever committed, Lord, for all the sins of the world. You bore them on your shoulder. You endured them on the cross for me. And Lord, thank you doesn't seem enough. There are no words that seem enough. But Lord, I just want to say this morning, I just want to say today that I'm grateful. And I just want to praise you and glorify you and give you all the honor for what you did for me. Lord, I pray that this service will just be honoring to you, and that you will be blessed, and that you will be pleased with the worship that we offer. In your great and mighty name we ask this. Amen.
Be faithful forevermore. You have done great. Psalm 27. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked advance against me to devour me, it is my enemies and my foes who will stumble and fall. Though an army besiege me, my heart will not fear. Though war break out against me, even then I will be confident. One thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple. For in the day of trouble he will keep me safe in his dwelling. He will hide me in the shelter of his sacred tent and set me high upon a rock. Then my head will be exalted above the enemies who surround me. At his sacred tent I will sacrifice with shouts of joy. I will sing and make music to the Lord. Hear my voice when I call, Lord. Be merciful to me and answer me. My heart says of you, seek his face. Your face, Lord, I will seek. Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger. You have been my helper. Do not reject me or forsake me, God my Saviour. Though my father and mother forsake me, the Lord will receive me. Teach me your way, Lord. Lead me in a straight path because of my oppressors. Do not turn me over to the desire of my foes. For false witnesses rise up against me, spouting malicious accusations. I remain confident of this. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and take heart and wait for the Lord. Amen. Hi, it's really good to be with you today. You've got a bit of a change. You had a change last week with Al speaking, and today you've got me. David's downstairs with the children and I'm up here with you instead. So David's asked me to share some thoughts on a psalm. The psalm that I've chosen is Psalm 27. You know, it was really difficult to decide what psalm to talk about this morning. There are so many different psalms and I love them. They're so varied in their nature, but all of them are able to capture the essence or the dynamic of the human relationship with God. And there seems to be one applicable for every scenario. You know, if we're feeling sad, if we're feeling angry, if we're lonely, if we're hopeless, if we're happy, if we're content, joyful. And it's reassuring to know that even the greats like King David experience these same feelings that we do today. For me, the Psalms are honest snapshots into somebody's experience and communication with God. Not rose-tinted, they haven't had all the bad or human bits deleted or taken out. It's all there for us to see and for us to empathise with. It's real. It was the psalm writer's experience, and often there are experiences today as well. The best thing for me though about the Psalms is the change that we see, the impact that an encounter with Jesus can have. We witness somebody bringing their humanness, their faults, their failures, their doubts, their worries, woes, anger, to an accepting and a loving God. We're so fortunate that we have a Father who accepts our feelings, a Father who empathizes with us before gently allowing his presence to change our humanness to holiness as we surrender those feelings to him. We see firsthand in David how God's presence changes everything. In the same way, being with him can't help but change us. We come in one way and we leave another. It might not always be our circumstances that change in the way that we like or the way that we would choose, but our perspective often changes after spending time with him. When we realise and we come face to face with his goodness, we're only too happy to trade our will for his. which we know is ultimately what's best for us. So I'm going to start by sharing a little bit of a testimony with you and link it in with why I've chosen this psalm for today. So this year, it's been a tough one for all of us for lots of different reasons. We've all been isolated. We've all been away from loved ones. We've all been, I'm sure, fearful at times of this virus that's been going around. And for me, this year has been really tough. We've all had different experiences, and we've probably handled those experiences differently as well. But my struggles, if I'm honest, I'm somebody who likes to plan. I like to be in control. And this year has taken a lot out of my hands. Also, I don't tend to deal very well with change, and this year has brought that in bucketfuls. It's also distanced me from the people that I love, and that for me is tough, it's hard. I get quite lonely and I like to be around other people. It's been isolating for us all. We've homeschooled here in our house, we've parented three small children day after day with no childcare for months and months on end. We've worked from home at the same time, we've been stuck inside, and on top of all that, we've brought a new little person into our family through adoption as well. And any of you who are familiar with that adoption process know that it can be complicated, it can be wonderful, it can be bittersweet, it can be stressful, and it can be quite invasive as well, quite draining emotionally. So it's been quite a tough year. Add in lockdown and it's taken everything to a whole new level. All of the things that we planned for settling in our little girl went out of the window, and life has honestly been quite tough. There have been times during lockdown where, if I'm honest, I've really struggled to cope, and that's not something that I'm used to. I've felt emotions that I've never really felt before. I've felt lowness that I haven't felt before, and darkness that I've never felt before. I've been physically and emotionally exhausted at times, and at times I've just felt done and I haven't really known what to do. I've just wanted to disappear, run away from everyday responsibilities, and for life just to be easy and fun again. But you know what? Each day, as I've come into his presence, he sustained me. And that's my testimony for this year. There have been days where I haven't really wanted to come before him, or I felt angry about things, or I felt sad, or I haven't really had the words to express how I'm feeling or the ability to change how I'm feeling. And even on those days where I've just shoved my headphones in my ears and I've walked out the door in the pouring rain with no words and just tears as I try and worship and listen to worship music and try and speak to him, he's been there and he's offered me just a word to sustain me, or a phrase or a verse or a passage or a song, which has always just spoken straight to my soul, and it's just kept me during this time. He's always given me something day by day just to show me that he's with me, that he loves me, and that he cares about me. I've honestly, for the first time in my life, really thought about how others who don't know Jesus cope when they come up against feelings and life events that make them feel like they're drowning, really. I've got a life raft who keeps me afloat, but people who have no living relationship with Jesus don't have that. They don't have that luxury. They don't have that person to always go to day or night. I've realized more than ever before how important it is that we introduce people to Jesus so that they have this life raft, they have this hope, they have this security, they have this friend who sticks closer than a brother. That's our purpose. That's what will fulfill us. That's what will make a difference to others. And, you know, we need to be obedient to the Spirit's prompting to do or to say whatever it is that he's leading us to. And if we do that, another person could potentially be in heaven with us one day. We need to share the difference that he makes in our lives. Not just that we're saved and that we're going to heaven one day, which is crucial, but also that he makes a daily difference to our lives, that he enriches our lives day by day and he gives our lives meaning. There have been lots of scriptures that carried me through valley experiences during my life or darker times, but one that's really helped me this year is Psalm 27. Psalm 27, when we look at its content and its purpose, is both a lament and a song of trust. And that's been my pattern really this year. Lament turned to trust. We know that although David is known as a Bible great, a hero, Israel's greatest king, we also know that he was extremely fallible, and his life definitely had ups and downs. Good times, difficult periods. This psalm shows David remembering God's goodness to him during his highs and trusting that another mountaintop experience is just around the corner if he just trusts during this valley. Often our emotions are deceptive, I've come to realise that, and they can easily be used against us. Feelings are often not truth. We may think in our minds that they're truth, we may feel in our bodies that they're truth, but they're not. God's word is truth. We may feel on occasions that God has left us, that maybe God's forgotten us, that we're not worth loving, maybe we've failed too many times. Trust me, I know those feelings can be all too real and they influence our actions, but they're not true. His word says, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I will go with you to the end of the age. I have plans for you. I formed you in your mother's womb. I formed your inmost parts. He knows the hairs on our head. And the Psalms say, O Lord, you search me and know me. You know my sitting down and my rising up. You understand my thoughts from far off. You comprehend my path and my lying down. And you're acquainted with all of my ways, all of them. For there is not a word on my tongue that you don't already know. As humans, you know, I think we sometimes can be so preoccupied with ourselves, unintentionally sometimes, but we're so preoccupied with ourselves that we worry about our daily sin and we feel shame. We feel shame about the things we do wrong, and then we allow that to distance us from God. We allow our guilt to separate us. But the Bible says that He casts our sin as far as the east is from the west. He chooses to remember it no more. Instead, John tells us that he chose to offer up his son himself for me and for you. I don't know if this is for anybody this morning, but this last season for me has really shown me that I really need to allow God's truth to override my feelings, because often my feelings, although they feel very real to me, don't align with what he's taken great care to write down for me. Sometimes I think I know better. I think my feelings are truth. I've learned to always go to the handbook. Don't look inwardly, go to the handbook. It's there for us. Remind yourself of what the truth is. The Bible tells us that the devil is a liar, and he loves for us to believe anything that separates us from God and his word, because he knows that it brings life and it brings truth. And he, conversely, loves death and deception. It's really important that we don't allow shame and our warped view of ourselves and our warped view of God to define our thoughts and actions. Nothing is greater than the grace that God has for us. It covers everything. Just because we struggle to wrap our minds around that and around that reality doesn't detract from its truth. So when we feel guilty or shameful or fearful, I want to encourage you to turn towards Him, not away from Him. He is provider. He is helper. It is Him who will build us up again and bring us strength. He is the rock that we can stand on. He is the shelter in the storm. He is the hiding place. He is the way. He is the truth. He is the life. And the answer is in His hands, not in mine, not in yours, and not in anybody else's. So Psalm 27 begins by talking about light. In Genesis, I've been reading the beginning of Genesis recently, and after creating the heavens and the formless earth, the first thing that we're told God chose to make, and the first thing that He called good, is light. Now, the Bible doesn't tell us what form this light took during the first 3 days. After all, we're told that God creates the sun and the moon and the stars on day four. This light was either created by God, making Him its source, or manifested by God. Some think that the light at this point was a metaphorical light, that the light that was being talked about was revealed truth. We also know that Jesus is referred to as light in the New Testament. It doesn't really matter which one of these forms of light was being referred to in Genesis, because whichever one it was, God was the bringer and He was the sustainer of it, and it was considered good. What's the purpose of light? It's the main source of energy for living organisms. It sustains life. It illuminates. It helps us to see more clearly. In fact, it helps us to see at all. It reveals the properties of the objects that it collides with. Sometimes when this reflection hits our retinas, the light reveals beauty. The beauty exists independent of the light. but it's only when the light illuminates that the beauty can be enjoyed by our hearts and our minds. David's dealing with stuff in this psalm. He's dealing with issues, but he doesn't come to God with a list of requests and expectations about how he wants God to handle his circumstances. I don't know about you, but I do that all the time. God, you need to do X. God, you need to sort this out by doing Y. Does he? Why does he need to do that? Do you know more than him? I don't know more than him, yet it still doesn't stop me coming before him like that sometimes. He is the author of all that is good. David's desire in this psalm isn't for a change of circumstances, although I'm sure he wouldn't have complained about that. His desire in this psalm is for God, the creator, the source, and the sustainer, to bring light and goodness to his life. David recognises God as his light in the first part of this psalm, his guide, his illumination, his energy source. David knows that it's God who can show him what he needs to do in the situation that he's in, and nobody else. Often we can look to the opinion of others and ask for advice off lots of different people. I know that I do that, but ultimately it's God's advice that we need to trust in. The Bible says that he goes before us. He has made plans for us. He knows what direction we need to walk in. David also talks about God being his salvation, his saviour. I heard a good quote a few weeks ago, and it goes like this. Jesus didn't come to make bad people good. And this is what lots of people believe, that we somehow turn into these perfect people once we're saved, once we know Jesus. No, Jesus didn't come to make bad people good, but to make dead people live. I was a sinner, and although saved by grace, I'm still a sinner. I do wrong things every day. I need Jesus day by day. I need his transforming power in my life so that I become more like him and less like Esther. He also refers to his saviour as a stronghold, a safe place, a hiding place. He knew that when in trouble, God would be with him. We're not promised trouble-free lives. We live, unfortunately, in a sinful world where terrible things do happen day by day. Our world is broken, and we're broken. What God does promise, though, is never to leave us while we exist here. He promises to help us, to equip us, to deal with whatever life throws at us. And even better, he's preparing a place for us where there will be no more tears and no more suffering. This first verse really sets out a clear theme for this psalm. When we come up against trouble, we can either choose to have fear or we can choose to have faith. Fear usually puts the focus on us, on our situation, on what we can do to affect the outcome. This, if I'm honest, is often the route that I naturally choose to take. Conversely, faith sets our minds on God's authority, his control of our lives, and acknowledges his goodness and that he is sovereign and in control. Verse 2 says that David thought that bad men wanted to hurt him. There was a physical threat here. I'm sure we've all experienced the threat of something. It could be the threat of people wanting to hurt us, just like David. It could be illness. It could be financial. It could be relational. It could be a bodily threat. It could be spiritual. But David's psalm says that these bad men fell down and that they did not hurt David. Perhaps David remembered his experience with Goliath as a shepherd boy out in the field, when Goliath said that he would feed David's body to the wild animals and birds. But David actually ended up killing Goliath. David believed that because he trusted God then, and God gave him help when he needed it, that he would do the same in the future. The same is true for us. Every time God gives us help, we're more sure that he will give us help in the future. We have a past experience to draw on. We all have stories of God's goodness to us, and it's really important that we call these to mind in those seasons. We sing a song quite regularly in church called The Goodness of God, and there are a few lines in it that say, "All my life you've been faithful. All my life you've been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God." Often when we sing, it's to give glory back to him. It's worship. Sometimes it's for the benefit of others, like a testimony. And sometimes we sing to ourselves to remind our souls, to remind our minds and our hearts of what he's done before. we need to recall to memory. You know, the Bible often says, remember. There's a reason that God tells us to remember. It's because we're human and we're prone to forget. We read a lot in these first two verses of David's fear, and I'm sure we can all feel fear at different moments in our life. And fear can be an emotion that can really take over. It can really incapacitate. David here is obviously feeling scared and trying to convince himself that he doesn't need to be. Does anyone else ever do that? I've got to be honest, I do. I'm naturally inclined to worry. I'm naturally inclined to fear. Fear for my health, fear for my loved one's health, what's going to happen, how will a scenario play out. I like to be in control, and when I'm not, I do struggle. I struggle with vulnerability, I struggle with trust, and these are things that God continually speaks to me about. I have to put myself down, often, like clay on a wheel again and again, to allow him to go to work, to smooth out all the places where Esther's tried to fix a bit here and fix a bit there like an amateur potter. And I have to allow the master again to perfect. It's a process that's repeated over and over in my life. That's my human nature. That's me allowing my human weakness and worries to consume me. But really, fear has no place in the heart of a believer. Even if, put what you will there, even if my worst fears become a reality, or even if the worst possible thing happens, you know, even in those circumstances, the people of God can remain confident and unafraid. The Bible says he has a plan for us, and the worst case scenario on this earth was considered by Paul gain. Even if my body dies, an amazing place beyond my wildest dreams awaits me. While, as I've confessed, this mindset is much easier said than done, it is possible, and David does outline how, and we'll look at that towards the end of the psalm. So moving on to verses 4-6, these verses talk about where God is. David says at the beginning of this verse that he has one desire. One desire. Can we all say that? I find that tough. We as Christians often say that, you know, we really love God with all of our hearts, but when I truly challenge myself and I truly ask myself if I want him more than anything else, if my words and my actions also echo that, then often the answer is no. It's easy to say, but not easy to do sometimes. The theory is yes, but the reality is sometimes no. To want God more than anything else, more than our families, more than our partners, more than our kids, more than our parents, more than all those people that we love most in the world, and to put his will above all of that. Often I want God to fit inside this neat little box. Yeah, I really do want your will, but I'd like to keep my husband until we're really old. Or I really want your will, but I want all of my kids to be healthy and happy and grow up to be really old. I really want your will, but I'd like to remain healthy myself, please. I want your will, but I want to live comfortably. I want your will, but I want people to like me. I want your will, but that's me. And I'm sure that's lots of you as well. Often there's a caveat. We need to have one desire. His will won't always align with ours. I, for one, want to love God more than anything. That's what we're called to do. It's a massive challenge, but one that's really worth it. To love him with all of our heart, soul, mind, and body. Not part. It's his beauty that we should seek, because the more of him that we see, the more of him that we want. Desire grows from knowing. Get into his word. Get to know him. He is the word. It's him who protects, and it's him who ultimately saves us and has so much more in store for us despite our failures. You know, I was thinking, if we continually sinned against those that we love the most in the world, if we sinned against them in the way that we daily sin against God, I'm sure they wouldn't stick around. Yet he loves us despite knowing our worst possible thoughts and things and actions, things that maybe only we know. Yet the Bible says he still chooses us. Yet often we put those people above him, people that he blessed us with. We see David in this psalm refer to God as his one desire, and then he directs us to where he can be found. The places are his house, palace, hiding place, and tent. Now, initially, we may think that these are different places, but they're not. They're the same place. They all describe where God is. For David, back in the Old Testament, it was either the tent where the Ark of the Covenant resided, or it was heaven. For us today, as Christian believers, the Bible tells us that apart from heaven, Christ has made his home in us. He resides in us and is always accessible. Jesus' Spirit is always with us. We are God's house. What a privilege that is. In verses 7 to 9, we see a change or a flip in the psalm, a shift. The first part of the psalm shows David either remembering God's goodness to him or experiencing God's goodness. The second part of the psalm seems to mark a change in tone. It seems that David is experiencing some difficulty. David thinks that God has forgotten him, and he begs God to answer him. Have you ever prayed and prayed and prayed and feel like your prayers are just bouncing off the ceiling? It's sometimes described as a desert experience. You feel far from God, or you feel that God may have left, he may have deserted you. You know, there's a poem that I absolutely love. It's one of my favourites that sums this up perfectly. It's called Footprints in the Sand. I'm just going to read it to you. One night I dreamed a dream. As I was walking along the beach with my Lord, across the dark sky flashed scenes from my life. For each scene I noticed two sets of footprints in the sand, one belonging to me and one belonging to my Lord. After the last scene of my life flashed before me, I looked back at the footprints in the sand. I noticed that at many times along the path of my life, especially at the very lowest and the very saddest times, there was only one set of footprints. This really troubled me, so I asked the Lord about it. Lord, you said once that I decided to follow you, you'd walk with me all the way. But I noticed that during the saddest and most troublesome times of my life, there was only one set of footprints. I don't understand why. When I needed you most, you would leave me. He whispered, my precious child, I love you. I will never leave you. Never ever during your trials and testings. When you saw only one set of footprints, it was then that I carried you. It's about perspective. What we can see or hear depends on where we're standing. I've used this analogy before, but it's really stuck with me. When we're in a storm, all we can see is what's around us, what our feelings are telling us, what our eyes are seeing, what our ears are hearing, what our past experience tells us. Sometimes if we board an aircraft in a storm, we see the rain, we see the wind swirling around us, we see droplets dampening our bodies and our luggage. We sit tightly in our seats for takeoff before ascending, drips still visible on our clothing and on our luggage. And then as the plane breaks through the clouds, we sense calm and peace, stillness, blue sky, a soft white carpet of cloud, silence. The experience below the clouds was still real, as real as it felt. The droplets are still on our clothes to remind us of what we've just been through. But at the same time, this calm existed. We just couldn't see it at the time. Our perspective often needs to change. We often have our eyes set on the storm. But you know, when we raise our gaze and we seek his face, things change. As an old hymn says, turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. We're called to live by faith and not by sight, to trust his truth and not our feelings, which change as fast as the wind and as fast as that storm. This psalm tells us that David's heart calls to mind this phrase, seek his face. Maybe it's his previous experience that tells him to seek. Maybe it's the spirit within him, God's own spirit, that tells him to seek. Either way, he's compelled to seek God, even though he feels that he can't find him in his current circumstances. He feels far from him. The Bible tells us that despite our feelings, God can always be found. He's always with us, even when our senses tell us otherwise. Matthew 7:7 says, seek and you shall find. Knock and the door will be open to you. It's like the game of hide and seek. My little boys love playing hide and seek. We can't always see the people when we begin the search. It's only after persisting that we locate them. And this is what we see David actively doing in the second part of this psalm. We see David praying into the little nugget that God has given him. Seek me, sometimes our prayers can be really self-focused, unintentionally often, but still they can be quite me-focused. We pray in our own will, and it's natural, we're human. I'm sure we all do it. When we seek God's Spirit, though, he helps us to pray in a better way. He drops things into our spirit and he guides us in a way that we should pray, which will bring us in line with his will. Here we see David doing just that. He seeks his father's face. He acknowledges that God has helped him before and prays in faith, believing that he will do it again. He asks him not to forget him. Verses 10 to 12 show David's confidence that God will answer him at some point. He's confident. He knows it will happen. He doesn't doubt it. Not all of our answers to prayer are in our timing. Sometimes they take a lot longer than we'd like. Sometimes they're not the answers we want. But God's timing is not our timing. David acknowledges that even if everybody else forgets him, including those closest to him, and he references his parents, he knows that God will not forget him. He knows that even though he might feel like that, his word promises that he will not forget him. He knows that there's nothing that he has spoken to God about that he's missed. You know, sometimes in the past, if I've been praying to God about something important, I've often said the same thing in 10 different ways just to make sure he's heard me, just in case he's missed one of the things that I've said. But the truth is, he doesn't miss a thing. He knows our heart's desire even before they're on our lips. He knows our needs even before we utter them, or even before we think to come to him with them. It doesn't matter how we say things, what words we use, how many times we say it, he doesn't need us to say anything. But the lovely thing is that he wants us to. He loves us doing so because it shows faith and it shows trust in him. We see in this psalm that David's heart desire is to walk in the path that God has for him, whatever that is. He references some of the problems that he's come up against, enemies, people that want to hurt him, people who lie about him, people who disparage his name. David, however, rather than defending himself or fighting against these kind of attacks, which is often our human response to things like slander, he prays for a straight path, a path that's safe. We often, as humans, resort to retaliation, to revenge, to bitterness, to holding grudges, taking things into our own hands, and often becoming as bad as the accuser. But God tells us in Romans 12 not to avenge ourselves. He instead says, "It is mine to avenge, I will repay." There's a reason we're told not to take things into our own hands, because things usually end up in a worse position than they were to begin with. Often our human emotions take over and we act in a way that we often regret later, a way that often doesn't reflect Jesus. Things are often best left to God. He promises to sort things out for us. And again, this may not be in our timing, but it will be in his, and it will be in the right way. Psalm 27 concludes with David taking the focus off himself and his enemies and encouraging the reader with some advice. The last part of the psalm begins strangely in some translations, some may think. It hasn't really got a beginning. In Hebrew, the verse reads, dot, 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 if I had not believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. This may seem a bit odd, but it's actually done purposefully, according to lots of scholars. It leaves room for us to insert our own experience. What would have happened to you if you hadn't believed in the goodness of the Lord? I know for me, my testimony is that I would have always believed that I wasn't good enough if I had not believed. It's different for all of us. What were we before him? You know, I love the word but in scripture. My husband made a joke the other day that he likes a but in scripture. But I do love a but in scripture. It shows us what would have been, but for the love, mercy, grace, and kindness of Jesus. But that small three-letter word has changed my life, and it can change yours. In this context, the but refers to my belief. But because of my belief in him, there will be an answer to my prayers. They may be a while coming, they may not be fast enough for me, but they will come because he hears them all. In the meantime, I can be brave, I can be strong, knowing that he is with me and will equip me with everything that I need until the day he comes to get me. We talked earlier about David's plan for success in overcoming fear. The key, David says, is this: wait for the Lord. Sometimes fighting for faith looks like waiting for God to come through. Standing in the strength that he's provided for me in that moment. Often he doesn't give us strength for what's ahead. He gives us strength for that moment, to get through that moment. This is what Jesus says about fear in Matthew. Do not be afraid of those who can kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, be afraid of one who can destroy both body and soul in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground outside your Father's care. And even the very hairs on your head are numbered. So don't be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows. Jesus promises his presence, and with it his peace. I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. Our peace is found in him. It's not found in ourselves. It's not found in doctors. It's not found in our job. It's not found in our family. It's found in him. Wait on him. We can be strong. We can be brave because we have him. You know, God doesn't always have easy things planned for us. He doesn't always ask us to do easy things. But it's in the difficult, in the storms, that we rely on his help most. And it's in these times that we have to cling to him. It's in these times that we draw closest to him, and in drawing close to him, become most like him and reveal his glory the most. You know, trials mold us, they shape us, they encourage us to cling to the Father like in no other season. We often don't have enough or feel that we don't have enough to get through in these seasons, but he always does. His supply is endless. I love the verse in 2 Corinthians that says, "My grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness." His power refines us like gold. You know, there's a song that I like, but in the same breath, I find it really hard to sing sometimes. Are there any songs that, you know, you sometimes find tricky to sing because you've actually grasped the severity of the lyrics? The song that I'm talking about is called Refiner, and some of the lyrics go like this. "I want to be tried by fire, purified. Take whatever you desire, Lord, here's my life." And you know, that's what it comes down to. Lord, have my life. Do with it what you will. Have your will, not mine. We say that line of the Lord's Prayer so easily it trips off the tongue, but the reality is so much harder. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Although things aren't always easy, although his will is sometimes actually really hard, we're called to be obedient. We're called to believe, we're called to trust, and we're called to allow him to refine. And when we do these things, we can know, we can really know that whatever we go through, he's right there with us. And so, these last verses of Psalm 27, I remain confident of this, that I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. And so I will wait for the Lord. I'll be strong, I'll take heart, and I will wait for him. And this has been my testimony over the last year or so, and something that I'm still working on, to not let what I see cause me to forget what he has said. It's fine to feel all the things. It's fine to embrace all of the emotions, to be honest about how you feel, to keep the lines of communication open with God, just like David did, so that you don't drown in those feelings or allow them to separate you from him. We need to be acting out of a place of faith, not a place of fear. We need to trust, to hand things over to him, to stand firm on his promises, the promises of a God who cannot and will not be shaken, a God who cannot be tempted to go back on his word. We can be content in his will for us, and we can be sure that he will equip us with everything that we need to run the race that he's planned for us. We can know that his plans are good. We're going to listen to a song at some point as part of this service, and it's called He Is. You know, he is. I am not. You are not. Often we feel like we haven't got what we need in lots of circumstances, but he is. He is everything that we can need and more. And the best part is, he wants you. He wants me. Hallelujah.
If you're troubled, heavy hearted, come to Jesus and find your peace. If you're run down, empty handed, come to Jesus and find your strength. He is hope for the hopeless, rest for the weary, help for the hurting. He is mending the broken, bearing the burdens, all that you're needing. He is. If you're wandering in the darkness, come to Jesus and find your the Prince of Peace, author and maker of everything, defender, deliverer, King of Kings. He is helper and healer forevermore, savior and shelter through every storm, my refuge, redeemer, and Lord of lords. He is child of heaven and son of man, protectors of great I am, Alpha, Omega, beginning and end. He is hope for the hopeless, rest for the weary, help for the hurting. He is mending the broken, needing. He is.